I wanted to say hi, first name, first thing. You know, everybody's talking about personalization, and you know, you're all persons, so we get that one out of the way. Welcome to this talk. So Braze actually asked me to speak today, and I'm excited to share some of my sort of personal experiences and personal views in building meaningful personalization experiences and customer experiences. So I work at a company called BetaShares. You might have heard of us. We're one of Australia's leading asset management companies. You probably know us from our range of exchange-traded funds. We have Australia's lowest cost Australian shares exposure and this and this and this. We serve through those products over a million investors and manage $38 billion on their behalf. But where I spend most of my time is in our recently announced and available in early access platform, BetaShares Direct. And there's quite a lot that goes into that journey of building that platform and making it a sort of personalized and engaging and quality customer experience. And there's some unique challenges and unique things that we've learned in doing that, integrating like multiple business units and the complexities around that. So I wanted to talk through those today. Just as some sort of scene setting. So customer experience, I put a box around it. Your customer sees everything that they experience as the customer experience. So while a lot of us might be marketers, we might be customer support managers, we might be UX designers or UX researchers, there is only really one customer experience, and it's the one that your customer considers. And so, you know, so should you. But now, it's personal. So I'd argue that customer experience has always been personal, but you know, now that we're all digital, and I think somebody said it earlier today in a really fitting way that if most of your transactions happen digitally, most of your registrations happen digitally, then being in charge of digital registration, digital transaction, makes you one of the most important people in the room. So we're all trying to make our digital experiences personal because it's what customers value. We know this, right? Every case study in the universe has pointed to personalized experiences, curated experiences, meaningful things that know the customer and understand their needs and make their lives easier, make a material difference to businesses. I mean, if you want to download the slides afterwards, there's all stats. So we get that information and let's launch, right? Let's get the first name merge tags. Let's do a special offer just for you. Let's put the name in the promo code. And potentially, if our customer's from Australia, we could throw in a little bit of a g'day mate. I don't know if any of you guys have ever received those from international SaaS vendors. But let's ship that stuff, right? You might find that a few of those things actually lead to some uplift, right? You might get better open rates, you might get better click rates, you might save some time on automating some of the content. But I've found that a lot of that stuff won't actually be enough to qualify for a customer's perception of understanding their needs and serving them personally. And on sort of the worse end, like the hundreds of brands in my personal Gmail inbox, you might come across like somebody who's just discovered that fast food employees wear name tags. So, how do we go beyond best practice? If we know best practice and we understand that that's what most people are doing in market, ubiquity can lead to invisibility. So I've got three rules for going beyond surface with your personalization program. Firstly, the most obvious one and the least exciting for you to hear, and obviously the hardest to execute, is getting your data straight and in the right place. If you do this right, the rest is easy. Skip it, the rest is almost futile. If you can achieve a full picture of your customer in one place with, you know, all business properties and unified interaction history, then you're able to actually understand your customer and also implement it in the tools that you have available to you. A few of you might have seen diagrams like this before. This is not specifically our diagram, but it is a CDP, an event stream infrastructure diagram. I would hope that each of you have seen something like this, but ultimately, using an architecture that's like this, or at least understanding how yours fits into your business properties, will be paramount to your success here. So, provided you get your customers' behavior on various different properties, platforms, tools, and route it through a CDP or any kind of service, so that your engagement platform, your warehouse, and your analytics all speak the same language. That means when you go and talk to marketing, you go and talk to customer experience, you go and talk to even, like transactional communications, these sort of things, everybody is unified on language, and the customer is one customer. The terminology that goes around is a single customer view, but you know, ultimately it is just one customer. And then on top of that, another painful task is making your data in plain language so it's usable. Plain language data will always trump more data. And so when you get it right and in a good architecture, things like inline personalization, using modern tools like Braze or whatever else it might be, become incredibly easy to execute and very fast to iterate. So do the work on the back end. Spend some time tagging, naming. Think about what's important. What is it actually called when somebody buys something? What is it called when somebody sets their preferences? And make sure that every downstream thing actually has that information, because the customer will notice when you're using it properly, and they'll notice when you're not using it properly. I mean, I've got a silly example here. Like, if your custom attribute for hobbies is called hobbies, and the value inside it is called hiking, then it makes it really easy and sort of scalable for your team to put hiking deals in the dynamic content. Very quick interlude. Any of you interested in AI and LLM projects will vastly benefit from doing this as well. So keep that one in mind. Finally, on data, I just wanted to mention that building a culture of experimentation sort of requires a culture of real measurement. When I've led experimentation projects in the past, you can end up with, again, I've mentioned improved open rates, improved click rates, more time on page, metrics like this. But if you're really integrating your server side and your offline events into your platforms, then you can find that meaningful connection between, did I do something that worked? And then your team can sort of go forth and work with that. Point two, it's a two-way conversation. Listen and understand. So we've talked a lot about data, we talked a lot about signals. If you listen to my previous point, you'll have used the time machine just now to go back and fix that and get all the customer data. We have all those signals then, right? But if you've got a clean customer profile and event stream, let's understand it and use it to make better experiences. So this study from Microsoft says that 72% of customers expect agents to have access to all information about previous interactions. It's pretty interesting, right? Because like we talk here about data silos, and this is, these are customer points from customer support queries, but it really does extrapolate across your business and across what you might potentially be trying to achieve. Similarly, from Salesforce, 70% of customers say connected processes such as seamless handoffs or contextualized engagement based on previous interaction are very important to winning their business. So again, all this stuff applies retail, B2B. People expect now that if they've given you information, you know how to use it and you know sort of what it's for. Let's apply a simple test. If I've just bought a dishwasher, which haven't recently, what should I see on my next app open and in the next newsletter? If you said dishwasher, you might be a recommendation engine that's not really that well thought out. And you might want to get that checked out, by the way. This sort of thing, I mean, we all experience this, right? It doesn't pass the sniff test, but who hasn't engage in this kind of shopping experience where you provide a signal to a platform and they come back with something that's incredibly, incredibly obvious to you. If I bought a dishwasher, I don't need a dishwasher. What I need is fridge. I need, dishwashing detergent. I need a discount on a subscription for dishwashing detergent, whatever it is. It's a perfect example of something that's deeply personalized, but it still managed to be wrong. So I implore, and you know, I've found a lot of sort of successful projects internally trying to understand what the behavioral signals mean and then sense checking the insights. So if somebody isn't completing an onboarding flow, you might not just need to send them a reminder. You might need to actually go into it, get the qual, get the quant, actually research and see, was it the reason that this person struggled with the onboarding the same as the reason this person struggled with the onboarding? And provide your communications and your changes to the product based on those things and try to do it per customer. The customer might have been hit with shipping shock or needed to provide a document for verification. These things can inform how you resolve them. And then personalize beyond what looks like personalization. This one can be difficult when you have, let's say, executive stakeholders or whatever else in the room that want to see this is the recommendations for you. But if something's personal, it might not actually look like it's personalized. You're not trying to prove to the customer that you've personalized. You're actually just trying to show them things that are valuable to them and take into consideration their usage patterns and their interests. So this can be executed through a number of different methods, right? You can use the content and you can use products. You can change the time of things. You might have somebody who has you know their schedule for a certain reason, and the send time should be adjusted for that. There's inclusion and exclusion rules and interaction based on settings a customer might have or stats of their usage. And then I think we also should sort of work towards the fact that our communications and our platforms are made out of blocks, right? Blocks which conditionally render and blocks that know who's looking at them and if they're relevant. I've just got a fun little example here. I received this email just earlier in the week and I wanted to to share it and add it to my point. So McDonald's sent me this email saying, things just got feisty, do you have what it takes? And it's an interactive email. They're kind of allowing you to roll those out on platforms now. There's this emoji-based slider that says, do you have what it takes? And when you click on that, it takes you to a mini sort of web landing view and records the interaction. Now, I haven't yet had the time to receive the follow-up on this, but if I was leading this project, the first thing you do with that is take that signal. The customer's given it to you. They've said, I like spicy food. So the next time a spicy product becomes available, I hope to everything that McDonald's is saying, we know that you're into this. You've told us. And then, have that on the profile. It can be there forever. Point three, respect the shopkeeper's craft. You might not be a shop, right? I'm coming from wealth management today, where personalized advice is not only difficult, but highly regulated, and if I'm not careful, quite illegal. The point remains, the shopkeeper's craft is about knowing your customer and knowing what they need before they have to think. Providing recommendations that are contextual to reduce decision fatigue. And if you've ever dealt with an incredible shopkeeper, I think you know exactly what I mean. With modern MarTech stacks and personalization engines, it's kind of seen as like the holy grail to do one-to-one procedural recommendation to your customers, automating the whole thing and showing them sort of, options and really just that one-to-one feed-based stuff. But I've got a counteractive point here. So one study by Gartner revealed that 63% of consumers are frustrated by interactions that feel too automated and prefer human interaction. This preference extends to content where human touch is seen as more relatable and personal. So how do we sort of work with that, right? Here we want to be one-to-one personalized, we want to scale it. But we also want to provide a human touch and sound we understand our customers. Well, I've just sort of illustrated something funny. This is not a scientific chart, but the cost of mid-grade content over the years has kind of gone up and down up until about last year, where it just went through the floor. So it's easier than ever to generate piles and piles of material. content, images, variants, variations. My point here is that conversely, that makes the value of something that's well-crafted, well-targeted, and human much, much higher. So like, you know, use this. Take the opportunity to create something pointed that speaks to your audience and show it to them at the best time. But use your personalization to mix in and get the best of both worlds. I said here curation's not a dirty word. And I think if there are, well, of course, there are quite a lot of marketers here in the room. If you're good at curation and you're good at storytelling and you do it often and your customers respond to it, don't lose that, right? The fact that you're investing in procedural recommendations or automated dynamic content doesn't change the fact that that's something that your customer might be valuing from your offering. So, yeah, I think like my point is just that combine the two. We got an interesting example here, which is a newsletter from a restaurant magazine and a recommendations email from a shopping platform. Now, we all know that Netflix and Spotify do personalization the best, right? They're kind of like your king brands in this space. But I wanted to try to work out why that was and find the common ground that they share. And I think it's here. It's that on the left is fantastic storytelling, and on the right, you have products that are picked for me. They are, you know, I mean, I don't know if there's anything you can learn about me from that image, but it's sort of, you know, it's smart, right? It knows me, but as a customer coming in and opening Netflix, opening Spotify, there's the things that are there for me, and there's the things that they're telling me are good, and I appreciate both, right? I come in and I love the fact that I can discover something, but I can also be given exactly what I was looking for. So please, you know, keep this one in mind. And like, if we've actually followed the previous two steps, to achieve the goal here, to smooth the customer's path to a quick purchase or better experience, you actually wouldn't need much ML or over-engineering to achieve this. All you need is good customer data served into the right platforms so you can use it to deliver meaningful communications. I'll wrap up those points and say, you know, in the end, no matter what industry you're in or product you're moving, we're building digital experiences for human users. So just keep that in mind. Like, would it pass the U test, like the dishwasher or the first name in the subject line? Those are my three rules. I would love to, you know, chat to any of you. I'll be hanging around at lunch with the Braze people, see how they might change any of your plans. Every business is different, but I feel like these three rules help to guide any project towards meaningful results. And as my title in the presentation alluded to, personalization is not a checkbox item. You know, doing first names, doing personalized promo codes, doing product recommendations is not completion. This is a forever journey. We're trying to learn about our individuals better, our customers, and really make products and deliver communications that mean more for them at the right time. Just quickly, I've been speaking here on my sort of personal capacity, but I've not been able to bring some of the sort of company stories just yet. We're still in early access. It's still sort of quite on the, you know, kept tight. But I would really love if each and every one of you did try to experience some of the things that we're building at BetaShares. BetaShares Direct is now available. And yeah. How likely are you to recommend? All right. Cool. Thank you, everybody.